Mai tata, mai tawhiti, ki ke tonu, e mea timata mō tātai, ka tukuna te rākai ki te pāpā, uirangi, e whakatūwhere tō tātai mō kōre. Kōre tātai, kia ora, pāpā.
Koe no kia ora tātai. Ko tātai mātai pangata i mea ai, a hako tako tō hau i roto te pāpā rākau, ko te tai au i roto tūranga. Ko tūranga whenua kāre ki te au, ko tūranga tangata. Ko tūranga tangata kāre ki te au, ko tūranga whenua kā ki te au. Ko ini rā ngā whakātūranga, e whakātūranga mō tēnī tō tātou kraua, ko ia nei tōna wairua kai wairui a tātou. Nō reira, e whakatū wherehia tō tātou hui. Ai hō, nōra he kurori e ki te ato mō maungārong ki rungi ka whenue, whakaaro pai ki ngā tāra. Amen. E iwa koe ni rā mātou nā kārangaranga kai waingi a mātou kono pai ki raro tu maru o tēnī tu mātou kai. E tuku atu nei a mātou whakamoe miti atu ki a koe mo tu whakawhai ti hanga nā waha katoa kai waingi a mātou. Ko noho nei mātou i raro te wairua o tēnī tu mātou kraua. A iarahi a mātau kurau, a mātau kuia, i tu wāi ora nei i roa te o tūranga nui a kiwa. Me tīnua no kia koe i hoa ke tau tō wairua tāpukirungi a mātau. Ke tutuki nā wawata nā tūmanako a tēnā mātau in o tahi nei. A hei mua koe a mātau e i hoa hei tōhutou i eri a mātau mahi katoa. Ko koe tonu hei pakakahe a mātou ke whai kroori ai mātou rua te āmahi. He mea tīmata, he mea mahi, he mea whakaoti rua te ākoe. Ke pipi ai mātou te oronga tonu tangata mea, to whai hiena i mātou i tēnei rā. Kroori e tonu a tapu. Āmen. Kia ora tātou.
Ka tiro tiro nua haukirunga, ka tiro tiro nua haukiraro ka titiro. Ki wanganui e kai whea ke, he oranga mo taku Māori tanga, kei tēnei tuku rāne, kei tērā tuku rāne, kei te pora anoa pē, pore pore mai anai. Ākuni ka riro te mana, te tapu tehi te wehi, e kia tiki te penua. O tia tiki te pō, me rā te wīwi, taku pāpā ngā pō, ki te motu whānui. Tu wā e tūmātai nungi tērā o nā papa ngā hau, nā whakataetai o te motu. Pohaka, koe nā te pātai. Māku pē, whakahuki a tēnā pātai o te pāpā, mai ngā mahi pēnei. Whakatika te kōrero. Whakatika te kōrero, ka tae mātai, ka haere, whakamua. E nari, kia tika o mua. Kia tika o mua tu mea tūtai. Ārere, kia ora tātai. Kau tau haramai tāpiti, haramai tata. Hungo manuhiri, kautau tēnei wā tūtahi ko urumai kautau ki wāinui a mātau o tūranga nui a kautau ki wā nau mai harapmai. Kura tātai. Nau mai, everybody, welcome to this first wānanga that we're having. On behalf of Ngāuri o Te Kooti Rikirangi, I bid you all welcome. This is hopefully the first of a number of wānanga we're going to have on the Kraua when we post-treaty settlement processes has allowed us the whānau with Te Tira Whakaari Trust, who's made up of Māori o Te Kosi, Rongo Whakaata members and Taitanga Mahaki members to put forward programs and initiatives like this. Kia tika te kōrero. Kia whakatika te kōrero mā tātā katoa. And we hope this is the first of a number, as I said. I confess we started with something āhua Māori, āhua safe. You know that our tipuna is a controversial guy. And knowing that we wanted to start this journey here, in this papakāinga's tūranga wairwai, we wanted it to be a long journey. Because when I put the proposal to my relations, I had about 2 pages of kaupapa on the kraua that we could discuss. So they've accepted this and they've let us run this. Thank you all very much, my relations. And we hope this is in conjunction with Ko rongo whakahate exhibition at Tairawhiti Museum. Those of you that haven't been there yet, please go and see it. It finishes in April, I think.
May.
It's been recently changed to May. And taonga there from Rongo Whakaata, and some of the Kaua stuff is there. We are lucky, and I thank the management, Eloise, and those of you from Tairawhiti Museum for allowing us to bring the Porere flag, which has been loaned from Te Papa, to Tairawhiti Museum to be exhibited at the exhibition. The Porere flag and the Kooti's other flag that was returned last year, I think, by Nelson College. So those flags are here with us tonight. He whakamahana, ya mata. Also, Mātai can expand on some of the pieces we have here. I don't want to spend too much time here because I've got other things to do. So Mātai can explain further, and including our guests. All I'm saying, he kamahana mai hara mai. Tahuri mai o te ringa, whiua mai o kanohi. Let's have a good evening. We've got three beautiful people who are going to speak on to us, and then but the majority of the evening, hopefully, is whakawhitiwhiti kōrero, pātai experiences, all that kind of stuff. We'd like to hear from all you. So without further ado, komiti hoki konei, tēnā koutou, nā mihi.
Kāti kia ora tātou, me hiko mā. Tēnei te tautoko ngā mihi kua mihia. Tūtahi tonu ki a koe te pāpa nāu i whakariti a tātou ki te wāhi ngaro. Ore kānui te mihi atu ki a koe. O tira ki ngā karangatanga hapū, ki ngā karangatanga maha, ko whakawhaiti mai, o rūmene mai i te pōnei. Huri noa, huri i tō tātou whare, tēnā koutou katoa. Mā tātou o waka, tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou, ko haramai nei te whakakanuhi tērā taha, o tō tātou nei koraua, kānui te mihi atu ki a koutou, o tira tātou katoa ko karapine pere mai nei, tēnā koutou, kia ora tātou katoa. I want you to turn to the person on your left and say, kia ora beautiful. And now turn to the person on your right and say, tēnā koe. On behalf of, I know, Wotike I taku aku te whakatau I a koutou, hoi anō te wāhanga ki au he tautoko, me te tuku whakamiha atu ki a tātou katoa. So, I just need to tell everyone that, as you can see, we have cameras around the place. We have Pōrangi Pōtai, Crazy Hat Productions. They are live streaming to some of our whānau that are watching, so big kia ora to the whānau watching from around the world who are tuning in via the Ipurangi. So kia mōhio mai koutou, hopefully you are sitting by who you are supposed to be sitting by, because we are live streaming. You do the maths. So nō tātou te whiwhi I tēnei pō, we have three wonderful speakers who have generously given us their time tonight. So I'm going to introduce our first speaker. Hei wāhi ngā kōrero. Nō reira, ōna pānga, kia ngai tūhoi, te aitanga māhaki, rongo whakātā nō hoki. He's an accomplished poet, writer, painter, trailblazer in Māori radio and television. Nāna te huarahi para, kia mātou, kia hau, mātou I roto I te āpāpāho. His current position is amorangi for the Auckland Museum, and he was recently bestowed an honorary doctorate by Unitech Institute of Technology. His traditional upbringing and his passion for Māori art and the ringatū faith, its founder, its scriptures, makes him an experienced and informed orator in this forum, as we're about to see. Ladies and gentlemen, whānau, please welcome Hoki mai ki te wā kāinga, Haare Williams.
Kia ora tātou katoa, e whānau e huihui mai nei ki konei tēnei wā. What a gathering. I don't think we can get a gathering like this in Auckland, because they're all jammed up driving cars on the road, they can't get to a hui like this. My background is I was born in Gisborne. I'm one of the Browns. I look brown, don't I? And my grandmother at Ohiwa wanted a child born in Gisborne. My dad married into the Brown family, Eriti Brown of Waiweka Brown and Mahaki Brown of Te Karaka, Puha. It wasn't until I was 18 that I met my parents and my brothers and our whangai sister and all my relatives. That was quite a gap, quite a shock. But the ideals of billeting out or whangai a child in another tribal area is an important tradition in Maori culture. So that the child is the bond between two groups of people, Tuhoe and Te Aotearoa Mahaki. But the thing I want to tell you, I grew up in a very, very rich environment. In faith, in rigatū, my grandfathers knew how to say sugar and baking powder and flour to go to the shop to buy it. But my grandmother avoided the shop because she couldn't speak English. And she knew three words in English beautifully. Michael Joseph Savage. So you know where the Labour Party comes into my family. And so I grew up in this very, very rich environment of ringatū in the language of the marae, the language of the church, ngā himene, ngā waiata, arawiri rāua ka horomana, Psalms of David and Solomon. I heard them night after night at 4 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, again when we had kai, again when we went to bed. Ngā waiata, arawiri rāua ka horomana, David and Solomon. David became a key part of my upgrade, my growing up. He was a hero. The stories of the Old Testament, the story of Joseph. In a minute we're going to hear about a part of the story of Joseph. And so the integration of church and language and English came together. Yeah, the English wasn't so good. I spoke no English. I went to school at 8. We lived in our own house. Wow, I didn't realize then how rich it was to live in a house like that, dug into the side of the hill into clay. The clay kept it warm in the winter and cool in the summertime. There were no bugs in our huts. They used the pollen from ferns to spray it around to keep insects out and use it for plants as well. The pollen from, you know, the big kapunga trees. They call it ponga now, I think. The big trees. They used the pollen from that to divert insects. So I grew up in that environment. Kōti was a historical figure. One of the things that worries me about our children, they're not hearing the stories of their heroes. How can they wear that as a badge of honour? How can our children wear the stories of their tūpuna as a hero? How can they become heroes? Our children can become anything they want. You know, one of the things I wanted to do tonight was to write a name tag and write under the word awesome, so that when you go to someone and say, "Kia ora, awesome, my name is awesome, who are you?" I've done this in Auckland and they love it and the children love it. But the hohonutanga o tērā kōrero, make sure that your children grow up knowing they are awesome, they are heroes. Our children are here, give them a big pakipaki now to honour our children. Do that publicly, eh? We don't honour our children. They are heroes. And how can they respect a hero like their mum if you don't treat them like a hero? You're a hero because your whakapapa tells you that you come from a line of heroes all the way down to Te Kooti and down to you. So our children are the heroes in our lives, whatever nationality it is. If you call our kids a little black rude word, you know what? They'll grow up to be like that rude word. But if you call them heroes, they're more likely to grow up as heroes. So don't deny school teachers who are here, don't deny our children any further for the richness that is them living in New Zealand. One of the unique things you have in New Zealand is you are Maori. Maori is now a brand word alongside the word All Blacks. The word New Zealand is a brand word. The word Maori is also a brand word in New Zealand. So live the way, find a reason, a purpose for life, and make sure that your children wear it as a badge of honour right there on their arm. Carry it to school. I grew up in that environment. I'm going to say something quite outrageous here. Well, it's not outrageous, it's quite true. Because tonight we're starting to know the truth about our history. You're going to ring a bell when I put my time down. When we come together like this, we need to hear the truth about New Zealand's history. There's no gain in telling you further misinformation, because there's been so much misinformation about New Zealand's history. The country still doesn't hear the story of New Zealand. The Waitangi Tribunal has done some amends towards retelling the story of New Zealand. Retelling the story becomes a new story for us, for our children. It becomes a story without powerlessness, without hopelessness, without fear, and without anger. The new story becomes a story about mana, about virtue, about what New Zealand is about. New Zealanders have yet to learn about New Zealand's history. I know only two politicians in the House who know the story of Waitangi. They don't know the story of Waitangi. So when are we going to come together? We'll come together when reconciliation kicks in, as Wirangi says, kataia. What a beautiful phrase. You know, you're lucky to have a Pope in Gisborne, Pope Charlie, because that's what I call him. He's the head of the Ringatu Church. Wow. I went to Parihaka recently, and when I walked onto the marae, I was expecting to be told about Te Whiti. And all they talked about was Te Kooti. I went to London in 1990. I was with the 1990 Commission. I go into the church. There's a bronze statue of Mandela there, about that high. Next to him, guess what? Is a bronze statue of Te Kooti. They're regarded as freedom fighters. Do you find a statue of Te Kooti in New Zealand? Hell no, you won't. So, you kids, when you go to London, find the church. I'll get the name of the church, yeah. And there's a bronze statue of Te Kooti in a church in London. These are the people who fought for the freedom of their land, of their families, and their people. So I'm going to say now, what I'm going to say now is that Te Kooti is the most outstanding general, pre-colonial and post-colonial New Zealand ever produced, ahead of General Cameron and ahead of Freyberg. I'm going to say it again, Te Kooti is the most outstanding general New Zealand has ever produced. Now, I've got to back that up now, because there'd be school teachers and a journalist in the audience wanting to know why I've made such an outrageous statement. But for me personally, that's not an outrageous statement. He is. Jamie Bellich said that Te Titokowaru was the most brilliant general in New Zealand. No, he was humiliated by his people when he had an affair with someone else's wife. And he was humiliated by the state. Te Kooti was never humiliated by the state. In fact, the state pardoned him in 1893 at Otewa in the Waikato area. And he came back to Wainui, where there's a monument there for him when he died. And he died where I grew up, at Ohiwa, at a place called Karaka. And that's where Te Kooti was wounded mortally. And then his body was taken to Hokianga Island in the middle of the Ohiwa Harbour. So I have a very, very strong connection with Te Kooti. And Tuhoe and the Whakatohea and the Whānau Apanui perhaps have been stronger followers of Te Kooti than the people here in Gisborne. I think at a stage in our life that all whakatos wanted to disown him because of the adverse publicity that Te Kooti generated around the country. He was called vicious, He's the most vilified historical figure. He is still dehumanized, and he's still looked upon as a terrible guy. So he is still vilified in New Zealand's history. So when are we going to start the trail? So I've got 10 points here. I'm not going to get through them all. I'm going to go run through them very quickly. The first thing that places him in my outrageous claim is that he was touched by divinity. Archangel Michael visited him and gave him God's plan for the deliverance of people, his people, across the Red Sea to the Promised Land. The Promised Land being New Zealand, to the whenua of his own people. While he was away, they took away his land, they took away his house. So he had a reason to survive. And the archangel told him, you're going to be a voice for your people who are living in bondage. So, some people say that it was a nasty event in New Zealand's history to imprison him without a case. But Te Kooti told his people, this is the will of God. If we are interned, it's the will of God. If we are liberated, if we're given freedom, it is also the will of God. But if we are to fight and die for what we think is right, that is God's plan. And I am the instrument of God. The second one I've got here is that he was a strategic planner. He knew how to battle. His motivation, his inspiration came from King David. It's all Bible stuff. Joshua and Gideon, the warrior kings of Israel, the warriors of Israel. Being the two is very, very closely allied to the Hebrew faith, the depth of it, the Bible. You're going to hear later on from two young people who are going to read a very prophetic piece from the Bible that prophesied the fall of the British Empire. Te Kooti made that prophecy. So prophecies are an important part of Te Kooti's deliverance. The third one I've got here is leadership. Many of us don't know about Whakatau Pōtiki. Whakatau Pōtiki is like Maui. It's that realm of people. And Whakatau Pōtiki had the blueprint for war. The word 7 times 7, those of you who know, will be 79. The hokowhitu a tū matauanga is 7 times 7. A well-trained army, 7 times 7, with two officers with absolute control, like David. David, King David, he had a group of 50 soldiers, well trained, and defeated the whole army. Te Kooti took his example from that. He only needed 50 or 49 well trained soldiers to defeat the enemy. The technique he used was deception. You put them off, you tell them something that you're going to do, but you do something else. The attack on Matawhero was based on deception, misinformation, lies, if you like. He told Peter of Kahungunu to go back and tell his people in Wairoa, I'm going to attack the redoubt in Wairoa on the 9th of November, I think. I've got to find the date. And tell your people to move out. He knew very well that they would go and gossip and tell them that the Kooti is going to come down here and wipe out our village. He didn't go there, he came to Matawhero. There was no one guarding the redoubt here. They're all gone, they've all went to Wairoa. Gilbert Mayer, Westrup, and Reginald Biggs was out of Gisborne. There was no one here. And the attack on Matawhero was not revenge, it was Utu. If you look at the principles governing Utu, it was, again, biblical. Utu is quite different to revenge. So the people who died at Matawhero, you know, you and I have read all the atrocious things written about Te Kooti, what happened. But at the end, he told his people to get off their horses, get on the ground, and pray, and sing the psalm, one of the psalms, to bless the people who had just died. And they took off back to Ngātapa, and pursued by the British troops. So he was a strategic planner in terms of his military genius. He's a genius. The third one I've got here is he was a composer. Weedung and I are trying to work out. Frank Davis told me that he composed over 600 waiata, karakia, panui, himene, and oriu, and waiata. That would make him the most prolific songwriter composer New Zealand has ever produced. Witi Himara is probably the most prolific writer in New Zealand at the moment. Te Kooti was the most prolific songwriter. Shall I say that again? Let it sink into our kids. Te Kooti is the most prolific songwriter composer New Zealand has ever produced. No one matches him. You know, we heard some of the waiata tonight. Pine pine te kura hau te kura, and so on, you know, his desire to return to Gisborne. Turn your back to the murderous weapons of the Pākehā. The Puhurihuri, his revolver, I've got the number of it here somewhere. Now I better not look it up, it might take up all my time. He had a revolver when cowboys in America were introduced to the revolver, you know, the one that spun around when you pull the trigger. He had one of those, and I worked with Judith Binney. Judith Binney couldn't tell me how he got a revolver in the 1880s. And he broke that revolver here, smashed it, broke it in half, and declared his peace, "No longer will my people." This is an aukati to remind my people not to cross that line in violence anymore. The end of the colonial wars in New Zealand. What else can I tell you about him? He was elusive. They got pretty close to him at Ngātapa, the massacre of Ngātapa. And Weedangi is very keen to do some reconciliation there. One count I've got from J.P. Ward, who's a writer, historian, he writes that it's 130 people were butchered without a trial. They were captured having a sleep, and there was no trial to figure out whether they were part of the group that came down to Matawhero. They were executed, stood up on the bank, stripped of all their garments, shot. Some of them jumped over rather than be shot. And I think one person managed to get away. Derek can verify that later on. But one of them got away and told of the butchery that was the execution of the people at Matawhero. So here's this elusive man, and they couldn't put a finger on him. He went left here, went to the promised land. When he went through Puketapu, he got all that. There were three columns of troops waiting there for an ambush to take them. And there's only a few of them, few rifles. They went from Whareongong, where they landed, on coming back to New Zealand. And as they went through the bush, Te Kooti told Peka Makarini, one of his, kia ora koutou. Oh, wow. Oh, ka tino rangatira tātātai kui a koutou. Nō reira, te wharakura o Ruatuki e mihi atana ka koutou, nau mai haere mai, piki mai kake mai. Ko koutou rai, awhine e tēne o tātou hāhi tō koutou kura. Ka nui ngā amuhi atu kia koutou. Nō reira, nau mai haere mai. The next one I've got is that he found redemption in the New Testament. A lot of the stories around Te Kooti is about the Old Testament. He told his people in peace. It was Waikato and Maniapoto and Tuhoe who really gave him the protection that he was able to survive and elude the imperial troops. He told his people that there's one thing I have learned from Christ. Before I die, I'll take this on. Forgiveness is a virtue of Christianity. It is something we didn't have in our culture, but with Christianity, the redeeming feature of forgiveness, turn the other face. And so I want my people to forgive these strangers who bring us a different language to this land, a different culture, different values to this land. They know not what they do. Forgive them. This whole process is laced with what's in the Bible. So forgiveness became a part of the Ringatū Church. Wirangi is talking about redemption for the crown. Māori don't need redemption in New Zealand. We don't have to be forgiven. The crown is saying, forgive us, we apologize. But that's not enough. I asked Tamati Kruger at Taniatua when the settlement was done there. I said, Tamati, $179 million. What's the price of $179 million? He said, it's not the price, it's the cost. The government still has to go a long way to meet the cost. To receive some redemption from God and from this land, the government has a long way to go. So forgiveness is an aspect of Ringatū. The power of forgiveness. You know, when we see the world in trouble now, people fleeing their lands, being bombarded, and children drowning in boats, you know, falling off boats, and where's that forgiveness? Where is the power of peace? We in New Zealand, I think we're shaping a country to be the most livable small democracy in the world. We've got to work at it. Māori have done their bit. It's the rest of New Zealand that's got to do their bit. It's the Pākehā side of the treaty that need to do your bit. Learn a little bit of te reo. Open a meeting with a karakia. Do things that are intrinsic and are virtue in New Zealand. This is your land too, you know. You've earned the right to be here. My family, William Brown, earned the right to live in Gisborne. My family comes from England. Yeah, he's a Pom, man. But we love him. He's our rangatira, he's our tukuna. I better hurry up. The next one I've got here is the future. Our tawira, our mokokuna, our children. Hey, we've got a powerful story in New Zealand. You live in a great country. You need to build it up. Your legacy. The legacy of Te Kooti is the Ringatū Church. A church, Te Kooti told his people, if our atua, our tupuna, our ancestors reside inside the meeting house, our kaitiaki, they all reside inside the meeting house, why build a church? At Omaio and near Te Kaha, there's a church built for Ringatū. And when Te Kooti went past, he said, your church is going to be for animals, for insects, and for derision. You know, later on, the house was filled with hay. There were sheep going in and out of it. They're doing all their poo inside it and mimi inside it. And it was infested with spiders. There's no church for Ringatū. Their church is inside the meeting house, the whare tupuna, the rightful place to honor. And Ringatū doesn't make a distinction between Catholics and Protestants. Every church is unified. Hence, my gathering of it, this is the reason why the Ringatū Church emerged, to unify all the churches in New Zealand. And I'm going to make one more statement. No other person before or since Te Kooti brought about a complementary relationship between Christianity and tikanga. Kia ora tātou.
I te iwi huma eno te pakipaki tō tātou nei rangatira. tāre kore kei a koutou wetahi pātai pia, he whakaaro pia. So no doubt some of you will have questions or comments regarding some of Papa Haere's kōrero. So tai hoake, puritia. We will have a short Q&A at the end of our session. We're moving, kei te tautoko I ngā mihi, kia koutou ngā rangatira o a pōpō, ngā tauiro te wharekura o rua toki, kei runga no atu tā koutou haramai. Tēnā koutou. This next man needs no introduction, but I better give him one, seeing he's got one of our t-shirts on. Took his matatini one off as he was coming in. For the purposes of this kaupapa, our next speaker is connected to all the iwi and hapū of Tūranga Nui Ākiwa. He's a visual artist, carver, tāmoko practitioner. His commitment to Māori cultural and economic development is demonstrated through his art gallery business in Gisborne, regularly showcasing local artists and his active involvement in both iwi and community initiatives. His ringatū and tūranga background will provide significant contribution to this forum, and his extensive formal credentials confirms the quality of his participation. E te iwi, no te haukāinga nei, o mai rā te pakipaki, Mr. Nick Tupara.
Kia ora te whare. I'm not too sure what I'm supposed to do just now, but I need to acknowledge Te Tira Whakaari for the invite to come and participate in this kaupapa. When cousin Ricky asked me to come along, I said to him, well, what am I supposed to talk about? And he goes, whatever you like. And I said, oh, who else is talking? Oh, Uncle Haere. I said, I'll fill in the gaps. Hey, come on, you can't fill in after this jacket. So I might appear to be unprepared, and that's the truth. So I came here not too sure what to do, and unfortunately the Karawa has looked down on me and decided that the papa should bring me a flag, and the Te Rāwhiti Museum in Nauri o Te Kooti should bring me a flag. So I'll talk about those. I brought a memory stick of some images to talk about, and if we still got a bit of time we might get to there. But I get to cross the magic rope and give a quarter for this. The pōrere is, as you probably know, not here. It's over by Taupō. And our people travelled across there after much of what Uncle talked about, drove them from this land. And they went that away. And there was a battle there at that place, and this flag flew to mark that those people were in residence at the pā. And if it became a battle flag because they got attacked and the battle ensued. And so we have this collection of battle flags that are really flags from where fellas come from. And when we go to our marae up and down the country and we fly our flags at Tangihanga particularly or at other occasions, because we don't get attacked, we don't call those battle flags. But these flags are there to identify who we are and who is at home at the time. And this flag is one of those. I'm not in school. The flag is a rallying point. It's something that the Karawa and his followers took as an example from the Pākehā settler soldiers who every morning marched around, put up a flag, saluted it. I don't think they did a wairatapa, but anyway, spent all day looking at it. And they identified themselves, they organised themselves, and managed their effort around the flag. And the Karawa and his followers adopted that process. And when you look at this flag, it's very plain. It's made from ordinary stuff, mostly. It's made from linen, cheap, readily available, every settler had a bit. And you couldn't go down to Spotlight and pick any kind of material. They took what they could get. And linen, plain linen, was a common material for them to make their art from. And I can see it here that with that they've got red cotton as well, again, the cheaper material, to outline some of the images. except for, I see here the dark red one that I see in our t-shirt. We've sort of redesigned it a little bit from the flag. The eye is actually a deeper, darker red. And I think that's some significance for them. It's made from wool, which sounds like, so what? But to have wool in those days was huge. Okay, because you barely had sheep, let alone wool. You didn't have a place to rock up and, well, go and buy a couple of rolls of wool and make some stuff. It was a harder to get material. And so it only features just fleetingly in one of the motifs, one of the letters here. And what I've tried to do is make a statement from the art materials that were available to them at the time. We understand, and Michael's probably going to correct me, we understand the crest of the moon. Oh no, I'll go back a bit. Artists are always going, bro, what does the symbols mean? 100 questions, everyone's going, bro, what does the symbols mean? And I've got to say, I've got to confess to being a very poor church-going ringatu. I've missed a lot of the ra. I haven't been to a first, I think, since Nanny Bucket Jones made me go to one. That's how long it's been. But when you go to those things, you have to sit there and keep quiet and listen to the kōrerōs and the scriptures that are there. And if you pay attention, which is hard for a lot of us to do, but if you pay attention, you will get to know the kōrerōs that fall behind you. And Uncle's mentioned some of those. Solomon, David, the archangel Michael. And I understand that Michael or Te Ariki, Mikaere, is a big influence on the flags. That Uncle mentioned about the visit the archangel made to Te Kooti on the Chathams. And it was funny, when I was thinking about this stuff, I thought I'd use the word Chathams, because that place needs to use its Pākehā name when it's referring to the exile of our people. Those people didn't exile our ones from here, Pākehās did. And it should be called that place in reference to the exiles. And while in exile, the archangel Michael appeared and spoke of the light of the moon, a light that's in the darkness, a light that will bring hope, a symbol for something else than the darkness that they were suffering at the time in the Chathams. And it's hard to sort of figure that, well, what suffering's that? I just came from the Chathams not so long ago. Seemed dark, but windy, but we had a nice sunny day. Suffering. Try to think of the word suffering. The pain of losing your place here and being put on somebody else's place, somebody else's whenua. Being tangata whenua and being a stranger. For a Māori, it's like huge. It's suffering just in the relocation. No mind the fact you had no kai, no mind the fact you had no clothes, no mind the fact that people were dying because they got sick and couldn't feed themselves and feed their kids. Keep in mind, there were kids to feed. Keep in mind, hundreds of them died. There was suffering, and in that suffering, in the darkness, the karaua discovered a light, and the moon became a protector for the heart. And right next to that, the cross. Whose is this cross? Jesus on the cross and all that kind of thing. Probably. But St. Michael had the red cross. Okay? St. Michael was a... if you've read your Bible and you go right to the end, because it's never mind about reading the bit in the middle, you just skip to the finale. Revelations talks about the four horsemen who come the day of the end of everybody are going to ride the planet and sort everyone out. Archangel Michael is one of those. If you see him coming towards you with the red cross, you know the end is nigh. Okay? And judgment is about to be put upon you. And that's, again, the Kaua was looking for an end to this, a beginning of something new. And the cross was something to follow. The W. Wow. I don't know what it means. People have suggested it stands for wairua, even wairua tapu, things that are sacred, things that are spiritual, things that ground us all as Māori in particular, things that tell us that there is life within to share around. Our wairua, our spirit is around. And of course the one, or the I, and I in terms of biblical reference, I is God, the one. Okay. And a very special fabric, in this case for our fabric artists, a very special wool fabric. Now that wool is, we have it taken a little bit, we'll have to ask the couple, we should sneak a little bit off and analyse the fibres, but it does suggest that material came from the clothing worn by soldiers that were hunting Te Kooti, from their uniform. And when you're a soldier back in England and you're also pretty much starving to death and living off potatoes, going into the military was a viable option for your young men. Because there was some wealth and opportunity in the military. And you got a uniform. That uniform was typically red, and then that would be carried into battle, but at some point in the battle, the Karawa has claimed their cloth and interwoven it in there. So it has a meaning for that as well. Now other one, Ifa's got to believe me because you can't see because of the funny angle. I could be making this up. Our next one, we understand it comes from Nelson Boys College. How it got there, we can speculate, but it got there. And we know that our tipunas went to that, they sent our elders to that their college as young men, particularly Kanetua, Rongo Whakata Halbert. They didn't just send any of the boys, they sent the boys. And they sent those with the promise and the hope of our people into a Pākehā arena to gain all of that skill and bring it back home to help our people. We know that Kani took taonga with him, because that's how he rolled. You know, just said, look at the photos, he's covered in taonga. And he took taonga with him. We know he took whakaero with him. And now the museum has examples of some of that. We need to get that back. But anyway, why wouldn't he take a Rangatū flag with him? Why wouldn't he take a flag of the Karawa with him? To afi himself, but also to have a piece of his home. He's leaving his land for another land. We don't know that for sure, but that's the speculation around that. And our old people were sending these young men to Nelson Boys home because we didn't have a kiote then. We were still deciding, should we do it or not? And then when we did it, all our boys started going to kiote. Okay, but before then, they went to Nelson, went to school there. And this flag turned up doing renovations at the school. They found the flag, they go, what's up with that? They had a little bit of a discussion. They had a discussion with their papa about it. They said, oh, gee, that looks like a Te Kooti flag. Even I got a ring. Bro, what do you reckon? Send me a picture. I said, bro, that's a Te Kooti flag, huh? So it became part of the reconnection of our people back to them. This one's a little bit more interesting. We know that wasn't a battle. We don't know much about this one, but it looks as though it's been in the battle. It's like when you get up and you know you've had a hard night because your hair looks like, ah. Well, this flag looks like, ah. It's got bullet holes in it. Okay, and if you look at those holes, you could think, well, maybe the rats did it. But around the edge of the holes, it's slightly charred. And the charred finish is because of the hot metal from the ammunition that was shot through it. And it actually has the essence of ammunition being fired at our people. And although we don't know much about it, every step of its life, we know that for part of its life, some of our people died under this flag. And the very small details in its fibres indicate, again, the suffering of our people. And what are the symbols? We've got another cross, probably Tiariki Hikaere, Archangel. We've got a heart. Te Kooti talks about that in terms of his other flags, particularly Te Wepu, the heart being the heart of the people. and the suffering they went through. It's got a figure, the figure, I don't know, who knows, it's the people. The trick with this particular figure is that it's in silhouette and the waha is open. And when I first saw that, I wondered, why would you do a figure like that? It's articulating a conversation, a discussion, a karanga, a waiata, a whatever. It's looking to address something. And that was something that the karaua, through all his time, looked to address for his people, the suffering that they would go through, the loss of the land, the loss of their culture, and everything else, the death and the bad health of his people. Looking to speak, to preach, and to bring understanding and look for a way going forward. And again, the materials are very, very simple on this, but that particular figure has the wool. It is the feature piece of this art piece, of this artwork. Okay, it has an elevation of significance. I could be completely wrong, but in the setting that the karaua has put here, certain things are given a place, and we do that all the time in the art that we're around here. I'm sure in Derek Lardelli Art Class 101, focus point, bro, you've got to draw the eye in. When you draw the eye in, then you can have a kōrero, you can have an engagement, you can then share an understanding. And I think in a similar way, these flags are doing that here.
I was unprepared. I'd like to see what good what sounded like. Koia ke apu, ngā mihi me ke apu nei. Ladies and gentlemen, e te whānau, I mentioned earlier that we are live streaming. There are people watching via the internet and starting to already send in their comments as well. So there's an opportunity that we might be able to read some of those out to you in a few moments. But first, of Ngāi Tā Manuhiri and Ngāi Whakaata descent, born and brought up here in Gisborne, a contemporary Māori visual artist and researcher, which complements his occupation, current occupation as associate professor, principal tutor, for the Skura here, Toihokura, School of Contemporary Māori Visual Arts at EIT. His focus is on reflecting Māori worldviews and issues of importance to Māori. His whakapapa and background places him in an unavoidable contact with many landmarks, sites and stories significant to the chronicles of the karaua, Te Kooti Rikirangi. And with his artistic passion and vocation, he is ideally placed as a speaker for this forum. He currently has an exhibition here, by the way, Ahoy, on display at the Te Rāwhiti Museum. E te iwi, ho mai rā te pakipaki, Steve Gibbs.
Thank you very much for inviting me here this evening. It's a privilege to be here, and I hope that, God, I've seen so many faces in here on an ordinary sort of weekday, so it's lovely to have you here to be part of this, and I'm actually very proud and privileged to be invited to speak. My kaupapa is really about Kooti and his influence, as I'll just get this sort of out, on Māori art. Now, excuse me 1 minute. I should have a ticket doing this. As an artist, we've always tied in Te Kooti to our brain. And one, as from an art perspective, he was many things, and Uncle Hardy spoke about him, and so is Nick. But one of the things for us was that, you know, he was a military leader, a prophet, an artist, but he was also what we call a shapeshifter. He actually made change at a time when it was really interesting to be living in Tūranga, and actually be interesting living in Aotearoa, but especially Tūranga or Te Rāwhiti. His influence crossed many areas. One was the Wharenui. He was active at a time when Wharenui were being burnt and destroyed. He was actually in a process of actually building them, re-establishing them, because, as Uncle Haile was saying, whare was key to the, what he saw as the survival and the maintenance of us as a people. He's also very innovative. A lot of the things we showed innovation with Te Kooti was, wherever you saw colour, that was a reference to Ringatū, because he didn't have any barriers in terms of what could be used. It also tells you what was happening at the time. Paint started arriving, lead oxide, lots of different colours, and there was no fear in using it, because they actually weren't making paint then, they didn't need to, this stuff started turning up. But there was no fear of how to use it, and you'll see this shortly. The other one was freedom of expression. In the sort of 1840s, a template had been laid down in this area. We're very fortunate. We've had this wonderful creative spirit here, and it made itself seen then through the work of Te Kooti, Rukupo, and the carvers that were currently living around Manatuki. So there was this amazing energy already here, and what he was able to do was to be able to engage, give the ordinary person a place within what we call Maori art. It was very direct. The process that they used to do things was actually, if something happened, they'd put it straight away into a space which you never normally saw. For example, the transition of the Po as being from a carved figure turned into a painting. And the figure was often painted, or you started seeing other images start to appear on what would normally be the Po, Hofakai on the photo. Very inclusive. The ability to include everybody in a community as part of the process. And, of course, community were very important aspects of how we operated. Lucas Bracken told us about this. The legacy that was already laid down in Tūranga at this time in the 1840s was this whare here, Te Hoki Tūranga. And it was significant in lots and lots of ways. One is because it's probably the first fully carved, painted and weaved meeting house probably in the history of Aotearoa. Because prior to this, there were meeting houses, or even the meeting house was quite a new concept at this stage. So in many ways, this was the first. The thing that you saw inside the meeting house, we started looking at what we now call Kōwhaiwhai. And then, of course, around about this period, we had the missionaries. So there was, Tūranga was a really interesting space at that time, historically. There was you had the missionaries arriving. We had, we were about to enter a phase which included the Paumarini, coming down from Ngāti Porou, originally from Taranaki, coming across the top of the East Coast, coming down this way here. That created all sorts of issues and problems for people living in Tūranga. So there was the template of Kōwhaiwhai being laid down. Also the template that Rukupo had set up with Te Waka Perehuka was the idea of carving was already a main art form to Hunga Whakaero. This was already happening in the 1840s. But something happened after that. So we have this notion of art reflects the society in which it exists. The 1860s and 1880s in Tūranga were an intense socio-political climate. There were political and religious realignment had to take place. Indiscriminate land confiscations, activities of the Māori Land Court, unpredictable actions of a series of European governments. Māori were forced to navigate this space. And this is the work, what Te Kooti did, in terms of his creative genius, was he started building whare. And these were quite unique because what actually started to happen was, things like this started to happen. Where you had whakaero, you also had the use of paint. But the other thing you started to see, you saw realistic imagery starting to appear in whakaero. Up to this point, the art of whakaero was really about very strongly iwi-based or haku-based, and they were to do with tupuna. This hadn't changed, but other things started to happen. And of course, this marvellous piece of architecture appeared in Tūranga in 1887, and it's called Ōwhai. This in itself, you have elements of carving, but most of it is painted. This is the interior. Where you once saw Fukaido, you were starting to now look at painting. And the type of painting is really interesting because it's actually, it's been called many names. One word is called naive. One word is called graffiti. But the nature of the process was a very quick process. But then of course, if you say the legacy of this, then you need to look at this. So, and this is part of the process because Cliff Whiting, who oversaw this project, did a lot of research and worked with some of the whare that Te Kooti built, as does his son, Dean. So you go back a step. This is the, in terms of innovation, you can look at this stuff here. These were po, which were normally carved, and now they're painted. One of the things about painting is it's very quick. Now these are some of the terms, you know, the development of a new art form started to happen. These are the terms, naive art, figurative art, folk art, primitive art, what we call a waituhi. The whole idea of making marks with paint. The interesting thing happened also in this period, it's a very short period in our history, and it was a very wonderfully creative period because it was innovative. New stuff started happening. But it was actually only happening because of what it was responding to. The socio-political environment was creating the space. You see here, a fusion started to take place. On the left-hand side, you have a, even though it's a po, but it's got kōwhaiwhai on it, so the context has changed. There was actually, you normally have whakaaro there. So you had we'd call this a conventional kōwhaiwhai design on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, you saw something different. You saw a plant form being painted, an organic form. It's not a normal pie, you see the idea of basically what was happening is if they thought it, they'd paint it. So the narrative was still strong. They still used the heke, the ribs of the whare was still used as a sort of a structure that actually represented the tupuna, but what's different things started happening. So you got this interesting array of painted messages of going on to the heke. And it wasn't just here. Basically everywhere where you had Dunga Tu or you caught his influence, you started seeing this work. This is a Ruatahuna. Even going up to Ruatoria. It's interesting when you look at the history of Haimariri, one of the things, when you have a quick glance at it, you think that Ngāti Porou were anti. You learn that there actually were quite some big strongholds up at Ngāti Porou who were actually Pai Māori. And there was a civil war up there to sort that out. And that war come this way. The idea of capturing events and situations that were everyday events. So there were no cameras around these days. So what they were doing, they were capturing and transferring what was actually happening at the time, which is quite, that's in itself an innovation. People. Interesting, these images. Motor cars, trains, ships. So you started to see, well, what was actually going on here? Now, this is actually quite, it was fresh, it was new. But then if you go to, Te Whangarā, this was sort of the very, very slick, beautiful, beautiful painting. But you still had the idea of organic forms. You had plant forms, you had traditional images, which would actually often be carved. Then on the heke, you had what we call traditional kōwhaiwhai. So there was this wonderful fusion happening. Then of course you take another step. Te Rangi, you had images, these were touched up by John Walsh. But the images themselves were still of interesting characters to appear in our horizon. Now these people actually never came here. I think the people in Whangarā never actually met these people, but their images were really strong. Yeah. They did. Still hard to tell you, sure they did. King George. So you had this, there's a shift that had taken place. Now this is actually, in the sort of 1890s, in terms of looking at this type of imagery, But what it did, it actually kept on moving. It didn't just belong to painting on Po, it shifted through tukutuku. The introduction of the narrative, you know, the use of words within whakaero and painting was actually a connection. And what it did do, it talked about the arrival of the missionaries, because there were no written words prior to that point. So with the arrival of the missionaries in this district, the words started to appear. It appeared in whakaero, in painting, and in this instance, tukutuku. And we talk about, well, briefly, what's the role of kōwhaiwhai? Where did it come from? The oldest examples we have of kōwhaiwhai are on Lahui, from this district. But then it transferred itself. What we learn also about kōwhaiwhai, or anything that happens in a whare, it's actually a visual language. This is from Raupunga Marae in Te Huki. On the left-hand side, you have the name of Raupunga. In the middle we have the Maunga, next one along is the Awa, and the next one along is the Kanai. So it talks about, it's actually, these are quite, I put them together, but they are all, you read them, as a, it's actually a language if you understand what the people are saying, so it's a way of holding our stories. Then it changes a wee bit, and I sort of still acknowledge Te Kooti for this, because there's a series of paintings done by Sawa Muru, and was based on the Parihaka series. There's a lot of paintings about, they call it Egmont or Taranaki. But when you had a Maori paint that same landscape, it actually changed. Because what a Maori does, from Maori perspective, is it talks about the issues from the whenua, tangata whenua, so you actually see what the land's all about. What happened there? Who was involved? And this is quite an amazing series of paintings that I think that they're still scattered to the four winds, but I know the Auckland Museum's trying to get hold of them. We shift into a sort of a contemporary space. There's a drawing, it's called Te Kooti's Flag, Te Wepu, and it's got the imagery on there, which Nick was talking to you about. The crescent moon, the cross, the mountain, the heart, the bleeding heart, the star. Down below that is an artwork done by Pana Machin, who's spent most of his life creating work based on Te Kooti. So there's Te Wepu using wood, steel, variations. It's sort of like a sentence, and he keeps changing the words around. But he's been doing the same stuff for the last 40 years. Then he shifts it into the same idea, the bleeding heart. You know, the bleeding heart isn't actually, it's a bleeding heart with an arrow going through it. If you analyse it, yeah, where did the arrow come from? Because we don't have the arrow within our sort of our visual messaging system. So it's come from somewhere else. And of course, in this instance, the bleeding heart came from the Catholic Church. So the legacy of Te Kooti then appears in public sculptures. This is the Civic Centre in Wellington. I think it's almost about 15 years old now. Yeah. Then his recent work is really still following Te Kooti. He actually calls it the Ringatū Te Wepu. He did a series of little sculptures this week, and he's turned them into large sculptures. And it references Te Kooti as the horse trader, and his horse, and his flag. And then 2012, he had an exhibition at the local gallery here where he worked on sheets of steel with a grinder, but still using the same iconography. Nonetheless, making quite a powerful statement. And the work down the other end there is by local artist, Megan Hanson, using a portrait of Te Kooti, but using wool. Quite a beautiful piece. They're like installation pieces. Then carrying on the legacy of other ideas, when we talk about that creative magic that still happens in a contemporary context, this is Brett Graham's work, a new poem in Karapiro, which is he just finished this last year, to make a statement. The statement he was making there was it's whenua around Karapiro, and the people are trying to develop it. And by him putting the sculpture there, they're saying that they won't be able to do that. because for them, the people from Karapiro, because the story of Karapiro was actually flooded. The actual pass site and all the village is actually under the water. So all that's left there now is the high ground around the outside. Contemporary artists have taken images and ideas based from Ringatua, Te Kooti, you get Shane Cotton, you know, the pot plant. The pot being an analogy for whenua and control, and loss of control. Then he's also done a series of works, one work, this is called The Diamonds and Pearls. And the diamond references a quote from Te Kooti talking about beneath every mountain there's a diamond. And your, one of your roles in your life is to find that diamond, because you're never going to find it, but you're going to find people that can help you do things. Then of course there's Bob Yonke, did a whole series of sculptures based on the iconography of Ringatua. So, under Te Kooti's influence, art became innovative, direct, powerfully expressive. The traditionalists, both at the time and subsequently, have considered it to be a degeneration of Māori art. But this is no more than the usual resistance against any form of aesthetic revolution. That's a quote from Frank Davis. Yeah, I'll finish that for you. So thank you for listening.
Couldn't get tickets to Adele, so you have to put up with me. Another big round of applause for Steve Gibbs. Thank you. As I mentioned earlier, this is an opportunity for us to have a bit of open floor for those of you who may have questions for Papa Haare, Steve or Nick, or any comments. Te Akuta, we've got our lovely assistants here with microphones at the ready. So please just feel free to put your hand up. And also, we may have some comments coming through via our live stream as well. So just check our mics for your head up.
Kapai. Oh, the other thing is, by the way, anyone that's contemplating crossing the road
to that big red sign over there, kei te pai. We have some other delightful treats for you afterwards, so we're going to invite everybody to stay for some real KFC after this. Kei te pai? Sir, yes.
I'd just like to acknowledge whānau kai and their suffering and in supporting Te Kooti after Wairangaheka and their subsequent loss of their rohi through the land confiscation for supporting Te Kooti, you know. Like you were saying before, Nick, that, I think it was Nick, that Rongo Whakaata sort of disowned him there at some stage. And then Wairangaheka, I think, is, correct me, Nick, was in whānau ākai's wohi and the maunga nātapa is up in the greater rohi, you know. So I'd just like the whānau to sort of know that, as Haere was saying before, that we don't know our local history, let alone our New Zealand history. And I think Derek's got to add another triangle on the side of Turanga, I don't know, those vehicles. You know. Just to acknowledge whānau ākai, because of the through the Waitangi Tribunal, they are trying to be recognised as their as a rightful. I don't want to use the word iwi because I was told years ago that that's a colonial term. So I suppose a hapu would be more appropriate. And because Papa Dave is not here, I thought I'd stand up and just sort of hold my hand up for Te Whānau Ākai. Acknowledgement to Uncle Charlie, Peter, and Hari, Derek, Mick, Steve. Kia ora whānau. Ko David Cameron, ahau.
Kia ora. Is this thing going now? Thank you for asking me. Just while you're thinking of getting some beautiful thoughts together and some pātai or kōrero, I just want to say that Steve has curated this exhibition. These works, nā aroha mai anko, mō tapu he, karanua aku e whakamaramatsu ki te hunga. Well, no, these are paintings from Uncle Haare Williams, who donated them to us for our use while the symposium was on. Welcome to come and feast your eyes. They're looking over our flags, which I think is just, I don't know how you did it, Steve, but the way they're lying is beautiful. One extra thing is, when I went to Uncle to collect these paintings, I saw his notes. So Cheeky Me asked him if we could, those are some of Uncle's notes over there as well on display. And these are some of his notes over there, if you can just turn your heads there, yeah? I was astounded. I think, if I got it right, Uncle, that those are Uncle's inspirations. Those are your doodles and your stuff that you write in his thin scrapbooks. And I saw them and I was, hicka, are you going to show us some more? Hold on, he's got his book. And Uncle's got a number of these books, and these are his inspiration that he calls upon when he's thinking of stuff. I don't know what you artists do, but that's nothing. The point I want to get to is he's allowed me to have these on display, and he's further allowed that I copy them out. And if anybody wants a copy of those things that inspire Dr. Haare Williams, I have them come and see me. Yeah?
Yeah, I'd like to suggest embracing the term naive arts. I think it's taken on a pejorative meaning, and that it sounds, the connotation now is that it's a symbol, a bit dumb, but the true meaning of naive is original. It's untrammeled by training or other influences. It just comes straight out of the artist. I know it's taken on a negative connotation, but in lieu of a better word, I think it's a good one. And I think if it's embraced, the positive side of it would come to light again. Because what we have seen today in the Rongopai paintings is not influenced, it's not trained art school. It's not, it's an original style.
I think Steve, you were the one that
pulled that term up, so you might want to look at it. The context I brought up is that it's actually, when you look at Western art has categories for categorising art. And when it comes to categorising Indigenous art, often the words are used are those words. But then in the Western paradigm, naive is actually a whole type of art form. And in the context of being an educator, sometimes the word naive means not knowing. But I think that's not to denigrate the artwork. I think the artwork was actually, in that 20-year period, it was some of the most amazing art we've ever done. It was socio-political reasons why, when we sort of tried to come up with a national art form, that art form was actually negated and in fact dismissed. Because what actually happened when Ngāti Rangatira went to re-establish Māori art, they went back actually to Rukupō, Te Haki Tūranga, which wasn't actually in Manatuki at this stage, it was actually in the National Dominion Museum. And they set their art school up based on that particular style. But they skipped over what that particular art that was created over that period in time, because it was actually a socio-political reason that it was not given the light of day then. It was only through a writer who put a book together about this art, and he called it naive art. And it was all the artwork that was created by, essentially, the Ringatū artists. But yeah, I agree with you. It's fine. I think it's actually, if you look at it, it's still, if anyone takes the time to look at the whole thing, it's actually really raw, beautiful, passionate art that probably a space that speaks more about how we were then, more than what we're sort of doing now.
Yes.
This is a question for either Steve or Haare or Nick Jim. I was wondering about the effect of colonization at the time that the Kooti was active and how it affected his creativity and his artistic expression. I wondered if there had not been a colonial period, how would Maori creative urge express itself with, you know, it would be interesting to speculate as to how, what path would have taken as a result. But I was more interested in the effect of colonization on Maori creativity and artistic expression. So if anyone of you three would like to answer that, I'd be grateful.
If we didn't go to war, I think this would have been changed, because another culture was coming here. And even without going myself going to war, I've been impacted on the colonial settlement regime right up to now. I was introduced very politely by Mātai as Nick Tupara, but in fact Nick's not even my name. The Tupara bit comes from Te Whakatoia, from my Mātātua connection. It comes from the, as I understand, the one and only cavalry charge that occurred in Aotearoa when they lined up just on the other side of the gorge and they rode the strait to Opotiki and killed all our people. And that's when Tarata and those battles occurred. And my tipuna back in those days decided he would take the name Tupara after the double-barreled shotgun. And our family has carried that from generation to generation, the mamai that comes off that. That's the battle half. The peace half was just as cutting. So I said, my name's not Nick. When my father went to school, his name was Manu Pofa. But because the teacher couldn't say his name, or because he wasn't allowed to speak Māori at school, every time he said his name, he got a hiding from the teacher. So on the first day of school, he went home crying. The second day of school, he decided to call himself Nick so he doesn't get a hiding at school. And whilst that's not a battle, that's a war that's being played out on our kids. When I was born, he was still proud of his name, Manu. And I was named for that. But because of the society we live in, everybody called me Nick because I was named after my father. And I've just carried that. But the Manu comes from Manu Tawhiorangi. Manu Tawhiorangi, who came from Taranaki. And my whole connection from the east coast to the west coast of this great country has been cut off because of that. So whether we went to war or whatever, we fight battles all the time and we fall victim to things all the time. Even when we're little and we go to school on our first day. Okay. He didn't bring a gun with him to school. He probably didn't even have lunch. He probably didn't even have shoes, no, the old man. He only lasted till he was 11. Because when you spend 11 years of torture, somebody goes, no bro, I'm going to take up a handpiece and I'm going to go share it. And just in terms of your question, you know, I think there would have been change. Oppression comes in many forms. And out of that oppression, as Derek and I were just discussing, you press something down and it begins to create something new. And I think the Karawas for Kāru would have come from somebody. Somehow we would have lifted ourselves up and we're still lifting.
Maori art has always been innovative, Maori art has always been innovative, but international art has always been innovative anyway. You go back to the Renaissance and periods in the evolution of a people in terms of so-called civilization, the arts have played a very big part. And in the evolution of Maori culture in New Zealand, the art again played a big part in the restoration of Maori culture. So Ringatū and the three meeting houses you saw tonight at Rongopai and Whaiatemotu and Tokanganui Anuhoe in Te Kooti. Until Te Māori went to the New York Metropolitan, Māori art in New Zealand was not regarded as art at all. Because Māori, I think, there's no distinction between art and poetry and literature and music and carvings and things like that are not separated. They're a seamless part of our literature. They're all part of our history. But in Western paradigms, those things are separate. Let me tell you the beauty of engineering in Maori culture, art, engineering and architecture. If you go to Auckland, that wonderful city that jams up with cars every morning and every night, where I live, when you drive out towards the Waitakere Ranges, you go past a mountain called Maungikikia. People know it as Mount One Tree Hill. Awful name. Maungikikia, beautiful name. You know, that's one of the biggest earth-made engineering, artistic, and architectural monument in the world. It's the biggest that's built out of the land. Someone argued with me and said that the pyramids are bigger, or there were Chinese walls bigger. Those have been built on there. They've taken the materials to build it there. Maungikikia was built out of the ground. And when you go on the top of it, you'll see over 500 acres of land covered with the space of Maungikikia. That's a work of art. No one can tell me that our people didn't know any mathematics, because that place is a work of art. It's a work of engineering and it's a work of architecture. They built those fortresses around New Zealand long before they did them in Britain, in Germany, in Europe. So Maungikikia, those fortresses were built to protect the mana of the tribe. And when you go, next time you go through Auckland, wave out to our monumental mountain, a mountain that is there to remind people of Auckland, the mana of the people there. Don't look at the obelisk on the top, because that's an affront to Maori people, to Tainui especially. Put there by John Logan Campbell. It has a story of confiscation taking over. There used to be 6,000 Maori people living around Onehunga, around One Tree Hill. Well, I use that word, Maungikikia, I should say. By 1867, there were only 23 Maori families living in Onehunga. Why? Well, I can let you figure out why. The greed, the lust, the pale face of power and money in Auckland. Yeah, that's a pretty tough thing to swallow, some of you in here, but you have to learn the truth. The truth is now beginning to emerge. The Waitangi, we can thank the Waitangi Tribunal, Matiurata, for putting it into place, and it was Korowete that took it retrospectively back to 1840. And people are still fearful of the Waitangi Tribunal. They think it's there to take land from Pākehā. That's not the role of the Waitangi Tribunal. The role of the Waitangi is find equality in New Zealand. Kia ora.
Anyone else? Down the back there. Tēnā. Going once?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes. Right. Someone at the back there? Oh, cool.
Kia ora, tātahi rā, he tēnei ki te tukumihi ki ngā kai kōrero ko tēnei pū, so Papa Haare, Mata Steve, and Uncle Nick. Tēnā koutou, mō tō koutou tuari I o mātauranga e pāna ki tēnei kōpapa. Ko tahu a pihe mā tōku ingoa, he ri tēnei no te tairāwhi te mei tonu. My question is, Papa Haare e Nukaipuru. Would you be willing to share your expertise and your resources with me in terms of developing an art curriculum for our high schools based on this kaupapa? The reason I say this is that I am endeavouring to integrate the Turanga Land Wars into Turanga Nui Akiwa Schools curriculum. And so this kaupapa started in 2016, and we've gotten up to the process where we've consulted with iwi and we've consulted with kura and we've had the all go. And so we're up to the stage where we're now applying for funding to be able to create the curriculum and the resources needed to deliver this kaupapa in the schools. And the reason I'm asking for knowledge and resources is that we've only been angling this from a social sciences and history point of view, and I can just see an abundance of mātauranga resources from an art perspective about this kaupapa. And so that's my part.
Te tangitaku whatumanawa, rungati a koe tahua e kōrero mai ana, ka hoki ngā whakaaro ki tō tupuna ki a Wiremu Kerekere, mahi tahi māu Wiremu I roto I ngā mahi whakapaoho, e kōrero atu nei tēnei o tātau I ngā āhuatanga te mamae o te tinana I ngā mahi with broadcast. So Bill Kerekere and I worked within a racist system in broadcasting to try and break the ceiling to achieve equality with the rest of society in terms of broadcasting. The government at the moment is actually curtailing the extent of Māori television. That's something to be condemned. Māori television is supplying programs now. They're being moved out of where they are. And yeah, I think it's a terrible mistake. But I'm gonna give you some of my rough notes.
I said no.
These are some of my rough notes that I draft my work with. But these are far more important than the ones over there. But the quick answer to your question, yes, I'd love to come to your rōpū and work together. I'm doing a workshop at Tapuhiki Marae with a group of young people. I hope you can come along too. And getting the young people to tell the story of Te Kooti and Te Aroha and to do the work at Marae, to paint murals, you know, quite big murals. We want to do four of them to fit into the whanakai. And so that'll occur sometime this year. And hopefully the inspiration. The important part is the talking about it and doing draft drawings. The finished work is for the other part of it. Engari ka nui tami ki a koe te aroha tuki a koe. You know, your uncle or your dad used to come to the studios in Papatoetoe, and one of them came to me and said, I want to be a broadcaster. And Henare Tewa gave him a microphone and said, go and interview that father. No, they took me into the studio, took this young man into the studio and said, okay, you interview him. And that's how he was introduced to broadcasting. So broadcasting is a noble career. Our children can get into a South Seas Film and Television School. The qualification to get in is te reo Māori. And if their tikanga is strong, a lot of the television announcers and people in front of the cameras and people working there now are graduates of the South Seas Film and TV School. Nō reira, kia ora koe, kia ora kami hea te kia ato.
Kana no hōtu?
He pātai a mōtaka. I see, actually what Rob's telling me, that there are a lot of artists in the room, and so taku pātai, would anybody be willing to create the curriculum required to teach? The art curriculum, not the history and social science. Thank you.
The koha or uncle, maybe? Here's the useless notes that uncle said he could have. But while she was talking, people, uncle ripped this out of his. These are the notes he wanted to pass to her. That's what I said no to, but he still ripped them out. So I'll copy these and I'll give them to you soon. Kia au tonu ki te koha a mātua nei.
Just 2 cents worth on that for our baby over there. She's screaming for help. She's screaming for help. Our kids are screaming for our stuff to be part of their life. And it's beholding on us all to share our stories. Yeah. You might think you know nothing, but there is something that you know. You grew up too. You were that age once, okay? And you do have stories in you, and you need to bring those out, articulate those, and give them to our kids. I understand, and I could be wrong, because I'm not a flash university professional, but I understand that when Apiranga Ngata came to put Māori kaupapa into the universities, and their excuse was, where's the resource, where's the books? And so he produced Ngā Mō Teatea and said, here's our poetry. And so he could begin their journey. And Baba is saying, the same thing is happening to her. Where's the resources, where's the books? They're sitting in this room, they're sitting outside there. Don't go home tonight and think this kaupapa is finished. Bring it together, compile it. I know I'm not the flashiest writer, but I could do the pictures. But we need to afi that call and bring our stories. We need to afi our hāhi and share our stories. We need to afi those that are leading the collection and the research into our history. I don't know how, uncle, but we need to afi that. If only accepting that knowledge, going to the schools and saying, I want my kids to do this stuff. When I went to Auckland University, art history was my thing. Went into there, the only Māoris in that curriculum were painted by Goldie or Lindell. When I got the assignment to do my a 19th century sculptor, I did rukupō. Then suddenly I got a call from the head of department, can you come in and see me? Because there is nobody here that can mark your essay. Okay? And I just thought, well, who do I pick? I can't pick some European joker, Henry Moore, or some other fella over there. I have to start from home. Baba is saying, let's start from home. Okay. Give her a hand.
Time for one more before we wrap it up. Pea, ko te wharekura. Karakau e pātai. Nui rā. Okay. Ka pai. Well, Uncle Ricky is just going to grab a couple of things. So, hoki mai ki tō tū Papa Haere. Papa ki kone noho mai a. Just going to live stream to see if anyone's got any thoughts. Did you see any hira, anyone?
Ah, yes. So we had a few people tuned in Brisbane. Whanganui? Whanganui? Come on, awkward?
Yeah.
Kia
ora.
Yeah. That aha you were talking about before you came.
Yes. Well, no, kia ora no tātou. Wā ko tai tata mātou ki te musu mo tō mātou nei hui. Nē kāre e kore. You don't go to a Maori hui without a kai, eh? So, and that's what we've actually been concentrating on the last 2 weeks, is how to feed you fellas. We don't want you to go away, okay? This is the formal part of our evening, kōchi. And kia ora ko tutuki pai tēnei wahanga. We started it off and there's not too many injuries, no scratches or anything, and we managed to get through this evening. Thank you all very much to our three kaikōrero. I don't know what to say, there's so many things. I thought I knew a bit about the fella. But I've got to go to school again with these guys. It's been fantastic, wonderful. Thank you all. Can you all join me, please? My papi papi ki ngā toko. Toko tōri papi. Previously, we've had the parades online from Kaidāpiti Museum. Thank you again, Aries, and your team. Uncle's exhibition, exhibiting paintings for us. Please look at his notes. Let me just go one more thing. I'm assuming a lot of you have programs now and flyers. Roxanne, please help me. So, this is my boss, the chair of the Te Tira Whakaari Trust, Roxanne Smith. Isn't it? Am I right? Come on. One of the trustees of the Te Tira Whakaari Trust and another Uri o Te Kooti Rikirangi, Lagi Cairns. And now that following is another trustee of the Te Tira Whakaari Trust, Marwa Thornton. These three actually let us have this. They were strong. As you can see, they're pretty female-ish. One of our problems in Rongo Whakaata is all these mana wahine. We've got three of them up here. They're my bosses. We had a good time, I think. I see more Rongo Whakaata women telling you what to do out there in the audience. Anyway, we've got a few little tāonga to give our speakers. And just before they do, see, we try to give all Nauri o Te Kooti a job. That's one of the reasons of holding these, so we can get have a job. And I need to explain this tāonga that we're going to present to our speakers. Baby, come and hold my speaker, please. See? Getting ready to do all kinds of jobs. If you see on your flyers, your notices, look at our sponsors. Yeah? We've got our sponsors, see our sponsors there? KE Design. KE Design's Tai and Katarina. They did these, they did the t-shirts, they did all the graphics and all this stuff. They were mighty neat. Te Rāpiti Museum have supported us, obviously. Not just on this, but other things. The middle is the tohu for Te Tira Whakaari. Yeah? So we've got another one of the Kauas Mokopuna. Maddie Thornton, is he in his third year, cuz? Second year at Te Puia, Maori school. I said, you got anything to make it to, you know, up here and thank these our speakers? That's Onewa. And that design is the tohu of Te Tira Whakaari.
And so,
Onewa from Obsidian. Yeah, Obsidian. Onewa from Torewe. So we're going to ask Uncle Haare to come up and receive it from Maiwa, please, Uncle. Come on. Get ready, Nick and Steve. Get ready, Steve. Come on. Bye, Steve.
Same here, isn't it?
And the fellow whose only name is Nick Tupara, sorry. And I know your father, but... Once again, people, we're going to open the doors. There's clays ready in the back. I'm going to ask Uncle Wirangi to close this part of our session and tuku karakia for us. Now, we want you to stay and talk. So we're going to clear some of these chairs. We invite you to get some kai. It's finger food only, so get a plate, load it up and come back in. On this side is wine, a bit of wine, a bit of juice, a couple of beers for you to stay. Please look at that. And the rest of the art pieces around here, it's just fantastic. We've had a lovely evening. What else have we got to say? Hanui nami? Oh, the last words with Uncle.
Te Kooti was about prophecies as well. The painting in the middle there comes from Daniel chapter 25, verses 22-26. King Balthasar had a dream, saw a hand writing a verse on the wall. And he was in a conundrum to find out what it meant. And he searched his whole kingdom to interpret somebody to come and interpret his dream. Not even his wise people could interpret it. And so one of the ladies said, "You have somebody in your prison who can tell you what that dream means." And the saying was, "Mene mene tekel pas." In time, your kingdom will crumble. Today, the British Empire and Europe is beginning to crumble. Te Kooti used that to inspire his waiata, Kahore te pō Morikarikana. There are three things that will restore the dignity and the mana of Māori. Tuatahi ko te tiriti o Waitangi. No one was talking about the Treaty of Waitangi in the 1880s. The treaty was a nullity. The government didn't want to know anything about the treaty. Tuarua ko ngā ko ti whenua. The second is your people will be queuing up in the highest court of the land, which is Parliament. All the courts in New Zealand, even to the Privy Council, there was no United Nations, but the highest courts in the world. Māori have done that. Tuatoru ko te mana mo tuhake. The third is your mana will never be depleted. Your language, your faith in God, and your faith in God in the Ringatū Church. If you have Ringatū, you're going to learn the Māori language. So those are the three prophecies. But this prophecy comes directly from David, who became the third strongest leader in that empire. King Balthasar consulted him to interpret his dream. Te Kooti used it to inspire his waiata, Kahore te pō Morikarikanei. And in 1963, Paul Simon composed a song called The Sounds of Silence. And we were going to play it for you, but we couldn't find it. But I'll read you just a few of the words for the song. You all know it. You do not know silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words that I might teach you. Take my arms that I might reach you. The sounds of silence. Hey, prophecies travel through space. Just as Moemoe, the Rogo Whakaata Kaitiaki, which is up in the mahau of the house at Manatuke, the great white shark, Mako Ururoa. What a great fish that is. The greatest creation of God on this planet is the great white shark, and it's the most feared. And Te Kooti was one of the most feared people in this country. People still fear him, and they fear the great white shark. Kia ora, we know.